My name is Chris Raymer. I'm a very grateful recovered alcoholic.
Yes,
I'm honored to be here. Gosh, it's great. Like old home week. Some of y'all I know well, and some of y'all I haven't met yet, and I'm just honored to be here. It's just I was talking earlier. This is going to be fun with Katie and Charlie this weekend, and I know some of y'all are not going to be able to be here tomorrow, and you're going to miss a hoot because it's. Sometimes you catch some resistance in audiences when you're coming out of the big book and you're a little thumper and, you know, people don't agree with you. You know, you ought to try to share the podium with people like that. You with us? And it's like a cat fight the whole day. And it's like, you know, well, this is what I really meant to say. And I didn't intend to, and everybody walking on eggshells. And so this will be fun. We're going to come at this tomorrow with an idea of how we take a newcomer through the steps at a pretty quick pace. We're going to walk through the steps at a pretty quick clip. I think one of the biggest mistakes we make in Alcoholics Anonymous, I'll tell you this, in all the 12-step fellowships, we just make this so freaking complicated that half the people out there just lose interest before they're halfway through. It's just not that complicated. I got to say this stuff going in the door and kind of give you a little point of reference. I nearly died getting to Alcoholics Anonymous, and I'm also a member of some other fellowships, and I dearly love anybody that's trying to get well. And I think I just need to say this, guys. I've been sober, I don't know how long, 22 years now. I got sober in 1987, and I spent a lot of time speaking from podiums early on. I'm really shy, except when I get from behind this podium, and then God kind of kicks in, and I kind of go 100 miles an hour, and I have a reputation for cussing from the podium a lot, and you know, I don't care what you think, kind of an attitude. And I just got to tell you, folks, I haven't cussed from the podium in years, and I care what you think. I get a little tired of being introduced as the asshole from hell, you know. You know, I had a circuit speaker friend of mine say one time, you know, he says, Chris says from the podium what everybody in the room would like to say at certain times but doesn't have the cojones to do it. And I don't want to be that guy. I don't want to be the bad guy. We talked to Mark a lot before he passed away. Over the years, I became quite sensitive to the fact that I was, you know, when you walk in a room and you got some people, I mean, come on, guys, some of us we've swapped spit for years. You know, we're thick as thieves. And some of us, you know, it's like you walk in the room and people, they don't like you for what you haven't even said yet. Y'all understand? They're sitting in the rooms waiting to be pissed off. And it's like, you know, this our fellowship is full of those people, and I can appreciate that. Y'all all like everything I've got to say. Chris, we appreciate your passion. We love you. You until I say something that you don't agree with. You with us? Katie and Charlie, they were just talking about the same thing, and then all of a sudden it's like, well, I can't believe he said that from the podium. That's just, you know, it's like, guys, man, buddies. One of the first things that Mark talked to me about was, let's look at your truth based on your experience. Not a head full of knowledge. Well, I don't know if this will work, or I don't know if that'll work, but it sounds good. What's your truth based on your experience? If going to 90 meetings in 90 days and spouting one-liners has got you sober and is keeping you sober and you're a happy little camper, how cool is that? Rock on. This is the bomb. You're welcome to do that. Y'all follow? It's not what the big book says. That's okay. But in the same breath, those meetings nearly killed me. That's my experience. Middle of the road solution. Watered down, weakened program, message. Nearly took me to a suicide attempt in 1987. And that's my experience. And that's just, I want to show you my truth based on my experience. I get thousands of emails from folks all over the world, thanks to a great, I work at a hospital, at a treatment center down in Texas, and I'm sitting in front of a computer terminal with an 800 number right there. You know, so I get to talk to people from all over the world, and the cats that pick up these stupid CDs over the last 20 years, and you'd be amazed how many people can relate to what we're talking about up here. But it takes the breath away when we come into a group of people and folks want to take shots about something they don't know nothing about. You know, it's like, it's my right to be 10 years dry in Alcoholics Anonymous, bone powder dry, miserable, you with me? Contemplating suicide or homicide on a daily basis. But that's perfectly okay. And it makes me sad to watch because Bill Wilson paints a completely different picture out of the book. And we're gonna talk about it some tomorrow. He talks about a program where we can be absolutely free and comfortable in our skin and excited about our lives. I mean, how sad it is that because some of us speak with passion from the podium, that we're the controversial ones. You follow? I mean, Katie said this something. She said, I feel comfortable in these rooms. I got to tell you, I feel comfortable in this room because I know so many of you, you know? And I mean, people that usually ask us to speak are not people that, I mean, we get the big book thumpers. We nest them out, you know? And so we're all kind of in the same trench. But I mean, guys, I've sat in meetings where I felt lost. Is we go around and share, and I'm listening, and I says, what? I was in a meeting in San Antonio not long ago, and I was talking to some of y'all about it, and I'd been on a bike ride down by the Alamo, and the Alamo's on Houston Street. Some of y'all come from the International next week, and we'll show you the Alamo. It's a pretty cool little place, but you can go left, like east of town, straight out Houston, and you'll see in some of the poorest parts of San Antonio is really sad. You know, with us, and I'm out riding bike down that road, and I'm the touring the neighborhoods, and it's just the poverty and the just the blatant public drug abuse and alcoholism. Y'all follow? And I said, God, I want to go to a meeting. I am so grateful that I'm in a fellowship, 22 years sober, and I've got a place to go, and we can talk about the steps in God. Anyway, I go to this meeting I'd never been to before, and there was a CA meeting, and I was going to go to the earlier meeting. I said, is there a meeting upstairs? And this guy stands at the door, and he says, yes. And I said, okay. What time does it start? 7:30. He's just upstairs. I mean, he's irritated, you know? And I walk upstairs and I walk into the room and there's a little circle triangle sitting on the floor. It's a little tag sitting on the floor. And I walk in. I said, well, that's the meeting. And I walk in. There's 10 or 15 people in there. Actually, there's 11 because I counted them. There's not a big book in the place. I've got my big book because I brought it because I'm going to an AA meeting. You'll follow? And we read how it works. And there's a living sober book there. Oh, my God. I guess I knew we were in the right room now. I want to puke. And they got a daily reflection, blah, blah, blah. But we don't have a big book in the place, right? So we go around the room and we start to share. And it dawns on me, because nobody's talking about the steps or God or alcoholism. You'll follow? I'm thinking, if I was a newcomer in this meeting, what would I think? What message would I get? You'll follow? You know, flashback to 1980 when I went to my first Alcoholics Anonymous meeting and walked up the steps. And they said, Chris, do you have a problem with alcohol? And I said, yes. And they said, welcome. And that's the last we talked about it. You know, lady was having a problem in the relationship, and we did. We talked about boundaries for an hour. And I went home, and I said, honey, we need to go to therapy. We need to set some boundaries up in our relationship. And she said, I thought you were going there to stop drinking. And I said, yeah, I know, but we never got around to talking about that. Maybe tomorrow night. God almighty. Oh, my gosh. So in the short time I got with you, I mean, I'll give you the little gist of what we're going on, but I just want to share with you guys, man, my story, it's my experience. If it doesn't jive with your experience, buddy, that's just okay. I got to tell you, in the United States, some of y'all have heard me talk about this before, but you know, we went through some major transitions in the 70s and 80s in the treatment center field in the United States, and we scooped up a big old net out there for a long time, and we caught everything that we could catch. You with us? Insurance companies paying like slot machines back in the States and back there in the day, and we got ever. Y'all know any of y'all ever seen fish? Y'all ever did? You don't ever know what you're going to pull in, you know? And the smart people, they'll keep the fish they want and they'll throw the rest of the way. Alcoholics Anonymous didn't do that. You know, we caught every little fruitcake and knucklehead in the world, every little disco drunk and party animal, we just scooped them up. Well, if you think you might have a problem with alcohol, you're welcome. How cool is that, you know? And they come into the meetings and they don't any more have a problem with alcohol than a man in the moon. Y'all understand? But they're here, and they're staying, and they're the vocal majority in our fellowship today. You can get upset about it if you want, but at a certain point in our history of Alcoholics Anonymous, we stopped qualifying the alcoholic. I'm an alcoholic if I say I'm an alcoholic. No, you're not. I've seen these people's Facebook pages. They suck. I don't know what to tell you. They look. You're a member of Alcoholics Anonymous if you say you are. Y'all follow what I'm saying? Anybody can be a member of our fellowship. And I'm not saying anybody can't. You're welcome. But the book spends the first 100 pages trying to explain to you the 12 steps. 60 of those pages qualifies the alcoholic. Walks like a duck, quacks like a duck. It's a duck. You know what I mean? And why we have such just weird meetings sometimes is that we got a room that was set up for ducks, and everybody's in there thinking they're cats, you know, and so everything gets a little confused and a little goofy and this stuff. You can share anything you want, blah, blah, blah. But guys, we're dying of this fatal progressive illness. Alcoholics Anonymous is the only game in town. I was talking to somebody the other day, and they said, oh, I bet you're excited about everybody coming into San Antonio. You know, it's in my backyard. I mean, the international conference. I'm going to tell you, I'm dreading it. Y'all understand? I'm loving it because I get to hug all my little real alcoholic, my brothers and sisters in this fellowship. I get to know. But how this place is not going to be peopled by them. It's going to be peopled by the little one-liners from hell. You with us? Oh, I get to hug. Oh, one day at a time, Mike. Oh my God. Who hasn't sponsored anybody in 20 years? But he goes to a meeting every day. Y'all follow? Can't hardly wait. I don't know. What we're starting to see is the same thing that Charlie and them were saying, and Katie was saying. We're seeing these little pockets grow up all over the world, folks. Little groups of folks that have come out of the closet with big books and dusted them off and said, you know what, we're gonna start talking about the solution the way they did in the olden days, and we're gonna get us some little knuckleheads to come with us, and I gotta tell you guys, some of you folks that I've met in here, Scott and here I met early on in Toronto a gazillion years ago, buddies. I'm gonna tell you, we took so many shots for talking about the big book from the podium. I mean, people get pissed, you know? I mean, downright irritated with us. And the world has changed a bunch, and there's so much more of us out there. Why? Because, guys, guess what? The best-kept secret, which is in the big book, the 12 steps, we're finding that actually works. We've got cats that are so pumped about this work. That's what we're going to be talking about tomorrow. And it's going to be uncomfortable for some of you because you're so... What's the word? I wouldn't exactly use that word, but rigid comes to mind. I can give you I'll give you a classic example. You know, when we talk about the newcomer, we want you to be open-minded and willing, you know, and we talk about the newcomer, but what about the 22-year sober guy? But you don't have to be open-minded, just the new guy. I mean, it's just like, when does the journey stop? We were laughing. Our little big book study coincides, and we were reading with a bunch of little mad dogs last night in Bill's story. And I've read Bill's story a million times. I come from a group where we study the literature over and over. And I'm sitting up there, and I got 40 guys in the room, and we've got our little books open, and we're reading Bill's story. And I'm not going to tell you which line it is, because you'll go, God dang, I thought he knew something. He's stupid. But I read this line, and it took my breath away because I had never seen it before. I'd never noticed it from that direction before. And this is what, I mean, the book speaks to us the longer we're sober. I used to be one of these big, Microsoft at work, we use the Microsoft soft systems, and I had a computer at home, it's the same kind of deal. You with us? And I had a friend in Phoenix that kept saying, Chris, you ought to try one of these Macs sometime. And we just have a little, I was such a snot, listen. Go Mac yourself. I'm not interested in that. You know, I mean, I've got this works, it's great. I know how to do it. I've got kind of a narrow understanding anyway. I know how to turn the bastard on now and off, and that's it. So, but anyway, I was stuck in Scotland. We were speaking in Scotland, and the hotel rooms had a Macintosh computer in there. And it was like, I called down to the reception. I says, this room doesn't have a TV in it. Can I move to a, he said, it's on the computer, you know, and so he said, punch this. All of a sudden, I've got a TV, I got email, I got it, and I'm whizzing on this thing, right? I email Patty back in the States and Texas, and I says, buddy, listen, we really need to look into getting one of these, you know? He was like, y'all understand what I'm saying? It's a perfect analogy. I'm so rigid. This is the way it's got to be. And then all of a sudden, you open your mind to the possibility that maybe perhaps something else could be better. Mark used to jam me up. He used to talk about my agnostic belief systems. Of course, I was a Christian. I was raised in the Baptist church, and oh my gosh, and I'm not an agnostic. And he said, "Chris, you're the most agnostic person I know. You'll follow? Because I believe there's a God. I just don't think he wants to have anything to do with me. I'm always worried about money. I'm always worried about relationships. I'm always worried about you with us. I'm just, God hates me." And he kept talking. I said, "Don't you think that God could take you to a different place? The miracle doesn't stop because we stop drinking. That's the beginning. Sobriety. That's the beginning of our journey. And unfortunately, in our fellowships, we've gotten to a place, in all of our fellowships, we've gotten to a place where that seems to be good enough. And it's not. I mean, we're going to touch on it this weekend. It is so not. Mark used to say over and over, "I smell more. I smell." A lot of y'all heard him say it. You know, "I smell more." And it just takes a little effort to get to it. And that's what this is about. It doesn't take near as much effort as you think. I was a professional chef for a million years and was pretty good at it. I wasn't such a good cook, but I was really quick. And when I found some of those outside issues, I got quicker. We could stay up all night long and clean and cook and chop, and everybody goes, "Oh my God, you're a super chef. What's that white stuff all over your nose?" And I don't know. And we're drinking like son of a gun anyway. And I had some Europeans that took me under their wings and taught me some cool stuff. And I was pretty talented. And I come from a great family, folks. I mean, I got to tell you, Mom and Dad, they were wonderful. And my father was an alcoholic. And I've got a twin brother that caught the genetic bullet. Guys, we're going to talk about this tomorrow in First Step stuff. Alcoholism and drug addiction, both, folks, is genetic in nature. I mean, the jury's in on this. This is biological, not psychological. And I know a lot of you guys are going to disagree. It doesn't mean that we can't use some psychological help too. But this is, you've got to be wired this way to be one of us. And looking at each other. Everybody got real uncomfortable because you've been sitting in meetings pissing and moaning about the bad thing that caused you to drink. And I'm not going to knock any of that, my friends. Please, I love you. That stuff exacerbated it and made it worse, but it didn't cause it. Good therapy can get you past that. Some great medications can help you with some of this other stuff. You with us? At a certain point in time, I've done all the medications. I've done all the therapy. You with us? And I'm still thirsty. Oh my gosh. And this is the hard piece to get people, because we didn't teach that in the 70s and 80s. We didn't teach that. We taught that this was causal. You with us? These little patients come into the hospital and they're just so confused. We get them in primary, we get them all detoxed, and we tell them, man, listen, alcoholism is a disease, guys. You're not bad, you're sick. And they start to get some hope, and you can hear them in there on the phones talking to their family. Oh my God, you're not going to believe this, buddy. There's some hope here. I've got this illness that's causing me to do this. And they get really excited. You with us? And they go to their first day in primary, out of primary, and they're sitting there with their first case manager, right? And the case manager just says, "So, Chris, tell me why you drink." Because I got a disease. I'm an alcoholic. Wrong answer. Why do you drink? Really? Y'all understand? All the air just got pulled out of him. And now we're back to causal. Y'all understand this? We got to turn this around. Sooner or later, we got to get back into the literature and understand what this is about. If anybody in here, please, has just heard me say that your external stuff is not important, you've heard me wrong. It needs to be addressed. It needs to be looked at. It will stop you from following the dictates of the higher power. It will stop you from finishing this work. It needs to be addressed. But we've killed thousands and thousands of alcoholics and addicts over the years in treatment centers by making that the issue and not the spiritual malady. Makes sense? We never got down to the causes and conditions, exactly what Katie was talking about. The root of my problem 22 years ago was selfish and self-centeredness. And let me be the first to tell you, today, it is still the same. Selfish and self-centeredness. That's what ruins my day. I haven't had a drink in 22 years, but y'all with us? That's the illness. That's the untreated. Why are we seeing such an influx? We're going to talk about it a bunch tomorrow, of people with long-term sobriety who are losing their sobriety. You with us? proving positive that just going to meetings doesn't solve the problem. Not knocking going to meetings. Hell, I still go to a lot of meetings myself. But the meetings are not what's going to fix the problem. It's the work we do. 1987, I'd been drinking. I was what we would call a functioning alcoholic. I got a lot of this other outside issue stuff happening, taking place in my life, but I'm holding it together pretty well. And I am not robbing liquor stores or going to jail or getting in a lot of trouble. I had a little some run-ins, some scrapes, don't you know? You know, but I bounce back pretty well, and I'm dodging that nonsense. But I am miserable inside. Y'all follow? And I've spent 7 years in Alcoholics Anonymous trying to address this. Every time I get my butt handed to me one more time, I walk back into Alcoholics Anonymous and pick up another chip, and then we sit down and we start talking about your day again, because that's going to help me stay sober. And then we'll go out to the picnic table and you'll tell me your story one more time about how many people you chopped up and put in plastic bags and buried out by the gym. And okay, and I'm not getting this. Do you know what I'm saying? I appreciate your sincerity and I appreciate the love that you shared with me in that meeting, but I can't stay sober listening to your stuff. People are trying to be so kind to me and so gentle with me that they won't tell me what to do. Y'all understand that most people are explained when they come to our fellowship that the steps are an option. that it's something that eventually, if you want to downstream, you can do. I got to tell you a quick story. Because I just got back on the bicycles again. I sold all my bike stuff years ago because I was going to move beyond that. And I missed it so much, I went and bought it all back. You know, so that's the nature of the beast. You should see what I got now. But anyway, I drive a 20-year-old pickup truck, but boy, this bicycle is something else, I got to tell you. But when I first started riding bikes early on, right after I got sober in the early 90s, I went to this bike shop with this guy, this big beefy guy. Some of you, my buds in here, like it. And we're riding with these guys, and they're all athletes. Okay, so, and I'm not. I'm a little skinny guy, and I've always been that way. And then, so we go into this bike shop, and a guy looks at me and says, "We'll set you up on this bike, but I'll tell you what I'm going to do." And I'll never forget it. He looked both ways, and he said, "Well, we're going to give you some different gears than he has." And I'm thinking, "Bitch, oh, come on, what? Yeah, oh, that sounds good." He said, "Chris, it's no big deal, but what we're going to do is we're going to give you some lighter stuff to push so that you won't have to work as hard as he'll have to work, and you can keep up better." I'm thinking, God, I came to the right bike shop. This guy really helping me out, you know? There wasn't anything in me that believed that this guy wasn't doing me the biggest favor in the world. You follow what I'm saying? Paid extra for these little pussy gears he put on my bike. Y'all know where this is going. We went out and started riding with these hammerheads, and they're all out there hammering it like this, pulling standard gears, and I've got these little lightweight gears, and the guy that can't seem to catch up, that can't seem to improve, is me. And I'm so frustrated because I really want to get better. I can't get better because I won't work as hard as they're working because the guy let me off the hook. And that's what we've done in Alcoholics Anonymous for years. We've tiptoed. This is what we do with a newcomer. I know. Let the tape show I just tiptoed. I don't know. We're going to do a pantomime lecture tomorrow. Oh my God. But that's what we do with the newcomer. We want to tiptoe around. We don't want to tell them. I mean, how many times have you gone into a meeting and somebody said, "Listen, don't worry about working those steps now." This is how the newcomer gets so confused. The guys would come up with me and the little guy, I never forget him as long as I live, is up in Denton, Texas, and he had an old beat up book and had duct tape around it. He'd, you know, the covers coming off of it. And he starts to slide up next to me and talk to me about the, you know, and lady goes, come here like this. And I go over and see, what? He says, "Shh. Don't go near that guy. He's one of those big book thumpers. Listen, all you need to do is just go to a lot of meetings and everything's going to be okay. You just promise me you'll come to lots of meetings." Okay. And I said, "Oh, I will. 90 meetings in 90 days. I can do that." You with me? Was that lady trying to hurt me? No, she wasn't. She loved me dearly. She was trying to save me the headache of doing a nasty old four step that she never had to do in order to stay sober. How did this lady stay sober? She went to 90 meetings in 90 days. You with us? But she wasn't a real alcoholic. She didn't need to work the steps. She didn't have to have a spiritual experience in order to do this. Y'all understand? This is what the book trying to tell us on page 34. Bill Wilson says it crystal clear. If you can stay sober on a non-spiritual basis, you're not one of us. Most people can stay sober on a non-spiritual basis. Whip them good. Threaten them with an arrest. You with me? A divorce. Let their liver start to crawl out of their chest. And they'll say, you know what? I was just fixing to quit. And they'll put the old plug on the jug. And they'll walk away from that stuff. And they'll be done. Because they have the power to do that. You with us? Fear can keep those people sober. Wanting to stay sober is good enough for them. Needing to stay sober is good enough for them. In 1987, I got to tell you folks, I've lost 3 businesses. And my health is horrendous. I'm hearing voices. Psychiatry has placed me on 7 medications a day. Antidepressants, anti-anxiety medications, some kind of suppository thing. I still don't know what that was. I'm on so many medications, I'm glowing. Y'all understand it? And I'm drinking on top of that. And when I can come up with the money, I'm doing little some of them outside issue stuff. Y'all follow what I'm saying? And I am miserable. I hate my life. What Charlie said a minute ago was so true. You know, you drink or drug in the beginning, and it's just like, oh, shit, where has this been all my life? You know, this is good, you know? At 17 years old, I drank my first bottle of Boone's Farm apple wine. It was about this big right here. And I'm walking back across that field and my head says, you know what? It's going to be okay. You know, for the first time in my life, I'm gonna be okay. And that's just, the effect produced by alcohol is not drunkenness. That's not what the book is talking about. The effect is a sense of ease and comfort. I get well when I drink. And everybody wants to focus on the fact that this is the problem. If you just quit drinking, everything will be okay. It was okay for that lady that told me not to work the steps. But for the real alcoholic, you lay the booze down, your life is going to go to hell in a handbasket. Because we're not dealing with a problem with alcohol. We're dealing with alcoholism. I'm 7 years in Alcoholics Anonymous and nobody will explain that to me. Why is it that more of us commit suicide in sobriety than we do out there drinking and drugging? Because we don't get better when we just don't drink one stupid day at a time. We get better when we have a spiritual experience and the obsession to use is lifted from us. We have treatment centers out there killing people today, telling them all they got to do is avoid temptation, triggers, and everything will be okay. And every time we talk about this all over the world, everybody laughs the same way, and then they go right back in meetings and talk about it some more. You with us? Every time you relapse, we're going to find out what happened, what triggered you. You know what happened? You didn't work the steps and have a spiritual experience. That's what happened. That's the bottom line. There's only 2 reasons that you will absolutely relapse. You don't know what the problem is, or you don't know what the solution is. Some of you will disagree, but if you'll think about that tonight, laying in bed, think about it. God damn, that little one-eyed guy's right. You don't know the solution, and you don't know what the problem is. You'll follow? Okay. It's like taking my car. It's broke. The mechanic says, what's wrong with it? It's broke. You got to get... What? What's wrong with it? That's what we do in AA. You with us? Little guy comes in. I'm broke. But we don't tell the guy what's wrong with him. That the spiritual malady is going to kick his butt. That alcoholism, a progressive illness, is fixing to reach up and grab him in the butt. And this is going to get worse. Y'all understand where we're at? We need to slow down. This is the first thing we're going to talk about in the morning. And explain to the newcomer what's wrong with them. So that they can have this urgency to finish the work. If you think you've got time to do the work, folks, then you don't understand what the problem is. Because it's grinding us up, buddies. This is why we're losing so many old-time members in the fellowship. 1987, I'm sitting in a small little apartment that my sister-in-law co-signed for me and up in Louisville, Texas. And it's a little efficiency apartment about the size of this podium. not much, really not much of an exaggeration, guys. And it's a cold Thursday night, and I bought a 12-pack of beer and went home and picked up a stack of return checks and opened them up. And there's the rent check in there, and here I am again. I'm 35 years old, and I bankrupted another checking account. Y'all know what it is? I own a business on paper. I've got a little screen print business, and I'm working for my twin brother, and I'm an accredited chef. I could go make a bunch of money, but I've got a couple of $100 in the bank. I'm living from paycheck to paycheck. You with us? I'm going to be on the street if something doesn't happen quick. And I'm just done. I've done treatment. I've done therapy. I've done the church. I've done 7 years of Meeting Maker Make It. I've got more desire chips than you can shake a stick at. Last time I picked up a desire chip, nobody applauded. I laughed. I am just wearing them out. You know what I'm saying? Because they know that I'm not going to stay sober. You just don't want it bad enough. You just don't want it bad enough. Not one of those guys ever told me to sit down and do the work. Not one of them. That's my story. I took a bottle of pills that night. 2 bottles of Valium is what I took. And if I remember correctly, and I washed it down with some Black Label. And about the time those pills hit my stomach, I heard a voice that said, "Don't do this. Go back to AA." And I don't come from a family that takes this kind of stuff lightly. Y'all understand that? I got a beautiful family, but there's no note. There's no drama here. I am sick and tired of being a loser because that's not who my daddy raised. And, oh my gosh, you know, family members, they think we don't know what we're doing. I got to tell you, folks, there's times that's true, but mostly anytime that stuff hit my stomach and I heard this voice that said, "Don't do this. Go back to AA." And I heard it voice twice. Rapid succession. "Chris, don't do this. Go back to AA." Not a thought. "You know, Chris, perhaps you should go back to AA." That was not the "Chris, don't do this. Go back to AA" is the voice I heard. And it freaked me out. And I've talked to a lot of other people that have heard similar things. The hair stood straight up on the back of my neck. And I made myself sick. I lay down on the side of the bed and heard the voice again. And I dozed off, conked out, passed out. And luckily I woke up the next day. And I heard the voice one last time that morning as I got out of bed, "Don't do this, go back to AA." And I was so sick. I was so banged up. I went to the doctor and I went to work. And at 6 o'clock that night, I went to a meeting I'd never been to before. I knew where it was because a guy had showed me. Some of you guys that think these 12-step things don't pay off, this guy had showed me where this meeting was 3 years earlier. He'd showed me. I was coming out of a blackout, and I called him on the phone, and he took me to a meeting in Louisville, Texas. And he said, "Chris," he said, "this is a nest right here of big book thumper fools in there." He said, "Don't go in there if you just want to go to meetings and get a date, because that's not what they're about. They study the book in there." And I remember, I'm smiling, thinking, "That's good to know." You know, and I remember making a mental note, I'll die before I'll go into that meeting. I mean, I'm just not, thanks for the warning. You know, I mean, I'm not going to do that. You'd never get laid in a group like that. I mean, why else would you go? And oh my gosh, but I was running late. You know how God was all over this? The little brother just said it, inches and seconds in some of these things. And I was running late, and I couldn't go back up to this other town to go to this meeting where I used to go. And so I'm going to stop off, get a cup of coffee, let some people know that I'm back in the program again, and then I'm going to go on home. You with us? And I walked in the back door of this meeting, and they were just like we're doing. They're laughing their butts off. Some of y'all have heard CDs. I've talked about it. They're all this back in the day, we could smoke in meetings, and they've all got 6 or 7 cigarettes out of their mouths, you know. You poor little guy. We ruined it for you new guys. That's all I can say. We just smoked one. Well, we didn't. Everybody's smoking too much. Ceiling's dropping down, and I'm walking in the room, and I wish I could describe what I look like. I always look a little rough anyway, but a big full beard I had, and I always had food in it, and, you know, and that big long hair. And that was the big joke when I got sober. Was that we didn't know if you were wearing an eye patch or an earmuff, you know, because of Just hard to look cool like that. I got to tell you, you know, and I'm 2 days without a shower, you know, and I have two things in my closet. I got a couple of Levi's and three Fruit of the Loom T-shirts. You with us? They come in packets of 3. In case y'all don't know that, you can get a blue one and a red one and a green one, you know, and you get them, you wash them every time, and a little pocket slides back over towards the middle. You know what I'm saying? You don't know if you're wearing a T-shirt or like pretending you're a kangaroo or something, you know, when you got the little pop. And here I am with these little t-shirts all sweat stained. I haven't bathed. You with us? I mean, I'm banged up. And I'm walking in and they're laughing. And you know how we get... The word is hypervigilant. Y'all know what I'm talking about? You get very self-conscious about who you are and what you are. And they're laughing and I'm checking my zipper and a patch. And what are they laughing at? I know they're laughing. They're not laughing at me. They're laughing at something else that's going on in the meeting. There's 30 people in that room. You with us? And I said, I can't do this. I'm detoxing in this meeting. I'm right at 24 hours away from my suicide attempt. And I took one step back and this little girl snuck up. She swears she didn't sneak up on me. I didn't see her. She came up on my blind side and I stepped back on her foot. She got her finger in my belt loop. And I've shared it from every podium I've ever talked from, guys. This is a little 19-year-old girl in Alcoholics Anonymous doing what she was supposed to be doing. You with us? You can't work with men. If she'd have been off in a little young adult meeting talking about young adult things, I'd have been dead. If it had been an old boy, you with me? I'd have just shoved you out of the way. She said, sit down, cowboy. You ain't going nowhere. And she set me down in a chair, and I sat. Boom. She's still sober today. And I am today because she gave it. Because she cared. Her sponsor couldn't get to me. It was a long, narrow room, and her sponsor saw me leave, turn around and to walk out. And she said, get him. And she got me. You'll see how that works? How God's going to use... We think we're so smart, you know. I don't know who I can help. You got that right. Your job is to show up and just be there. Oh my gosh. Anyway, they sat down and the chairperson saw me and gave me the high sign. He'd seen me in North Texas for years and gave me a big old up, you know, welcome back. And they said, chairperson took charge of the meeting. You know, it was the same old stuff. You know, it's like freaked me out. First time I'd ever seen a chairperson do that. You know what I'm saying? You got a guy in there practically dead in the back of the room. Oh, we got a newcomer. But I think tonight we're going to talk about relationships. I don't know what it is about it. We either want to talk about relationships or let's tell Chris how we got here. It's like, buddy, I know. Let me guess. Oh, shit. Let me guess. You drank too much. What are we doing? Oh, my gosh. Like, you're going to scare me into the rooms again, you know? Oh, my gosh. They didn't do that. They said, Chris is back in again. We're going to go around the room. You guys that have worked the 12 steps, let's share with this guy how our lives have changed as a result of working the steps. You with us? Wow. Yeah. That translates to those of you in the room that haven't worked the steps. Be quiet. Proper term is Pat. But again, it's like Mark used to say, I wish people, when they shared their opinions, would say in a meeting, I'm sharing my opinion. Because the little newcomer coming in the door doesn't know that you don't know. You with us? How many times have you guys been in a four-step meeting? And the little guy comes around, he's just got out of treatment. Well, I haven't done a four-step, but this is what I, you know, no. Shut up. Be quiet. Talk about what you know. Talk about what you have experience with. Because that's what the newcomer's going to gravitate to. They went around the room that night and they talked about getting their money back and they talked about getting credit cards and getting married and buying houses and doing all the cool stuff. I'm less than 24 hours away from a suicide attempt, right? And this guy's giving me the one thing. This room is sharing the one thing that I need more than anything. And that's hope. Hope. Can you wake up in the morning and not obsess about alcohol? What a concept. And yet we want to paint this picture that every day is a day you might drink. Whoever got up earliest today is sober the longest. I beg to, by God, differ. Oh, my gosh. Again, we're candy coated. What kind of hope is that to give to the newcomer? Why in the hell stay sober a week? You're going to lose it anyway. Oh, my gosh. Good heaven, there's no hierarchy here. It doesn't mean we're better, but good God, that's why we need the old timers back in the rooms, sharing their sobriety dates, picking up chips, to show us that this thing works. I know I can stay sober a week. I've done it 1,000 times. It's that month that I'm having a little problem with. It took me 7 years to pick up a 30-day chip. You'll follow? The next day, that night, the guy got around me and he asked me if I was ready to stay sober for good and for all, not one day at a time, for good and for all. He said, we're going to show you how to live life one day at a time. Are you ready to do this? And I said, yes. And the next day, they were on my doorstep. I hated that shit. You know, with this, because I've forgotten a lot of that stuff. I mean, I know what I said last night, baby, but this morning, and I'm running around cutoffs looking for my patch, you know, and who in the hell's out there? And it's the guys from AA, and you know the look, you know, he's got a little book. I'm going quick. He's got a little big book, and he's, you know, oh no. And he says, I'm supposed to bring him back up. And he did. He took me back up to the meeting. We went to a 10 o'clock meeting, and we went in the back room. We chased a bunch of Al-Anons out of their back room, out of their meeting room after the meeting. And we got back down there, and we did a guy asked me if I had a problem with God, and I said, no, not a bit. And he said, he explained the third step prayer, and we did a third step prayer. And we went to lunch and came back. He gave me a notebook, says, hey, let's start working on that fourth step. And I said, Mom, man, I'm not ready for that. He said, buddy, you've had 7 years to get ready. Start making a list of the people you're pissed at. And I said, your name's on it. You know that. And he did exactly what we're doing right now. He laughed. He said, yeah, I know. I expect it will be for a while, too. And he said, but I love you, buddy, and I want you to get well. And you're not going to get well if you just sit on your butt. You've got to get into some action. And 2 weeks later, I'm sitting on the tailgate of my truck, and it dawns on me that the obsession to drink is lifted. 2 weeks in, and I've recovered from alcoholism and drug addiction. And the obsession to drink and drug has now returned. So. Guys, the same miracle that took place in Bill Wilson and Dr. Bob's life, these guys work in the steps quickly and they come out the other side and the obsession went away. And I know there's some of you in here that are still fighting this on a regular basis and the desire continues to come back. And I'm telling you, that's not... Let's do the work, because there's a reason for that. And that's just what we try to teach people in treatment centers and the guys that I sponsor. So let's get its cause and condition. The big book says a price has got to get paid. It means that we got to start destructing this self-centeredness, and that's how we work the steps. My ego is so huge, guys. We're going to talk about it tomorrow. And that's what the steps do, is they keep my ego right size. I don't want to be better than y'all. Y'all understand that? Don't ever hear me that I'm 22 years sober and I'm better. No, come on. But I don't want to be worse than you either. And that's where I spent all of my life. I could walk in, used to go drink at an ice house down there in Houston. You know what an ice house is? Old beer joint on the street, and they pull up the garage door, and everybody sits out in front and drinks. And you know, and I'm out there, and I always would put a tie on before I would go into this ice house so I would look better than these guys. I'm hoping none of them knew it was a clip-on tie. You know what I'm saying? But that's the way it was with me, because of my ego. I'm either better than you or worse than you. And it's all the same lens. It's all the same thing that's going to block me from you, and eventually it's going to block me from God. And by working the steps, I got spiritually connected. Guys, it hasn't been easy. My life has not been easy. It's been a wonderful journey, but there's been some huge sadnesses in there and some trauma, and good God. But I get to walk through it with your help, with grace and dignity. I wanted to commit suicide in sobriety one time around a divorce. It was a tragic deal. There was a little stepson involved, and it was just, it broke my heart. But not once did I want to drink or drug, because the 10th step promises had come true. It had placed me in a position of neutrality. And somehow, guys, we got to get a whole bunch of people trying to represent this program the way it's supposed to be represented. This is about power. This is about permanent, by God, sobriety. This is about sobriety, being able to walk through stuff with grace and dignity and come out the other side and not walking on eggshells worried about the day you're going to wake up and think about drinking. That's y'all understand where I'm at. And it's not the picture that is usually presented by Hollywood about Alcoholics Anonymous. We're a punchline of stupid jokes, folks, because the message has been so dadgum watered down, it's not even funny. And we as a fellowship need to grab this thing back, 75 years old. We've damn near lost it. And what we're going to talk about tomorrow is how we can work these steps. And if you'll come back tomorrow with an open mind about this and ask questions and bring a little notebook, and if we say something that doesn't ring true to you or confuses you, let's talk about it. Let's visit about it. We can do it question and answer from the podium. We can also do it in at the breaks if you don't want to with us, if you're too shy to ask. It's not complicated information we're covering, but it goes against what a lot of us have been taught. And that's what makes us uncomfortable. You with us? I'm going to say this and shut. I cannot tell you how many times we've had these workshops and we've talked to people, and people get uncomfortable and they come back down and says, well, my sponsor said, Well, my case manager said, and I'm not knocking any of that, case managers or sponsors or whatever, but Mark used to say, if you can't reconcile it with what's in the big book, you might want to hold it suspect. Or how's this working for you? Because you're going to hear some things new. You're going to hear some things that may go against what you've been doing in the past. But if with a little open-mindedness, it might work a little bit better. It might change your life. And that's what we certainly hope to do. I'll say this because I know some of you guys are not going to be here tomorrow. You got work to do and things going and you didn't plan to do it. But I got to tell you, any of you that can join us, we'd love to have you. Those of you that can't, I mean, absolutely. You